a good start to it. And we're off. Welcome to the Songwriters Powwow with Thomas Walsh. Couldn't think of a better launching pad for the powwow interviews than that beastly roar.
That's a little frightening though, wasn't it?
Like, at what stage did you start to have, like, I'm not sure you had music lessons or anything. Like, when did you realize that you could, that music could be a profession for you, that that this is something that you could do? Like, was it quite young or?
I used to go out to my dad's shed and pick up sticks. I know this sounds like something from the 20s, but I used to bang. I used to have all these plastic drums because we had a huge shed at the back end. We had a big garden because we were a forced house. So I used to drum. Yeah. And I loved the fact that it seemed like I could do it, right? And I loved doing it. So the more and more, you know, I got into that, my dad said, well, you know, basically just started asking for the drum kit. And my dad had no connection to anything in that respect because this was like late 70s, yeah, pretty early 80s. But my uncle Billy sorted out a drum kit because he lived on the north side. Yeah. Cool. You know, that's why I have a lot of respect with north side, even though I'm a south sider, of course. Yeah. But you always have to respect that there was something extra going on over there. They knew something. They knew how to get a drum kit. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. And was there drum lessons involved?
God, no. Jesus Christ.
Was your brother John playing, or did you just play together, or did you just fall into it? Or?
Well, that's what happened then. I played the drums. I didn't have an interest in guitar then, but I used to love the drums, so I still do. But anyway, play the drums. But he started going to, like, in Emmett Road School, where I went to my secondary year in Inchicore, right across from Commandum Jail on the hill. He went there on a Wednesday night, I think, to learn guitar chords. You know, this is one of the earliest things I can remember about lessons being given. Yeah. That was a kind of a technical college, a technical school. So he used to come home on a Wednesday night and go, I learned this chord. And I remember he showed me, and I used to just kind of go, well, what's that? And I'd pick up, because we had this Egmont guitar.
Yeah.
Which the action, you could put your head between the strings and the actual guitar. Yeah. That's how the action was that high. And they always say learn on a difficult guitar when you're starting, because when you pick up a guitar, like in a shop, and it's an electric, a brand new Strat or something, it's like your fingers have gone through the neck in a hologram.
Yeah.
It's so easy to play. He showed me some chords. So every week there'd be a new chord. But when he came home with F, that's what started my life struggle with music. I immediately got a panic attack. Yeah. And I went down that weird road of music.
Until you found the capo.
Not really. I used to play F with the,
you know. All major sevenths.
Yeah, because I couldn't flatten that finger. I'd be like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then bar chords helped. Because
yeah,
you couldn't. You know, so the bar chords were a big, big thing. F is a gateway chord.
When you go from those regular chords into the bar chords, the majors and then the minors, you're definitely opening up a whole world. So you're learning the drums, actually similar to me, drums, and then I learned drums, bass, and then guitar. So, but I think having the drums and the bass, like when you were listening to music, did that make you hear music in a different way now that you could see the chords and that you were playing the drums? Were you... Was your relationship to being a fan of music moving somewhere else, like somewhere deeper?
Very quickly, for me, that's the only thing I have, because I swear to God, as you know, arm, hand, whatever it is, coordination is dreadful when it comes to picking. So I just can't go, you know, I can't play riffs. I honestly, I mean, I could sit down for months and I could probably force myself into it, but why? It would cause eternal anguish. So what I just knew I could do was, the minute I hear a song, like, so if I heard Mr. Blue Sky when I was a kid, it just sounded like, that sounds like F.
Yeah.
And so you'd go over to your guitar and you'd put the record on and then you go, oh God, it is, you know, that thing.
That's something that I've noticed that you had, like you've always stood apart, you know, to other musicians, is that you have this musical gene inside you. I don't know what it is, but you can just... I could say a song to you and you'll just play it. You'll just, oh yeah, I think it's here. But it's also your, I don't know if it's a physical thing as well. You're able to find where the chord is. Even though you're always saying, I don't have a big chord range, or I don't have a big, but you have a great sense of the general music of something and you can just put it across, you know, very quickly.
Don't they normally say it's a good ear? That's what they normally say. But good ear applies. You watch Rory Gallagher and you watch you getting on stage and being able to just go straight into a solo that's mind-blowing, and you go, I'm constantly in awe of other musicians anyway. I don't crave them to come back and say nice things because I know what I can do. You know, that's what I do. I don't get hung up over it, really. I do hate the fact that I can't get up in a jam and suddenly go to the front and go, you know. Yeah. But the thing is, it's funny because George Harrison was such an amazing guitar player. It used to take a forklift truck to get him out front to do a solo.
Yeah, okay.
Now, and when he'd do it, it'd be quite simple, but he'd be brilliant, of course.
Yeah.
Well, he was very, very, and I loved that. I live by that because he knew his place almost, and he was so humble to know it, even though he was George fucking Harrison.
Yeah. But I think as well, his guitar parts were very much composed. Like, they weren't like jam sessions or improvised things. They were really these wonderfully composed pieces of music within Lennon and McCartney songs and within his own.
Yeah. I totally agree with the fact, Colm, that there's definitely a songwriter's way of playing.
Mm.
If you're first and foremost a songwriter, now George Harrison would be first and foremost a guitar player, I'm sure he'd say. But to be honest with you, like I've worked over the years with, say, someone like Jason Faulkner, right?
Yeah.
Who is a brilliant player and plays with the best of people, you know, but obviously Air for years and Beck now. He's a brilliant player, but first and foremost, he's kind of a songwriter.
Yeah.
So when you work with him, he plays the drums in a very different way. He plays them very melodically.
Yeah.
And I suppose it's like Dave Grohl as well, that he plays drums in a very melodic way because he's actually a songwriter now.
Yeah.
Even though he classed himself as a drummer, it's amazing what you can bring to the table if you're a songwriter and you play a lot of instruments. So that's like George as well. So George was very melodic in his guitar playing because he started becoming a brilliant songwriter.
Yeah. So it's all about composition then, really, isn't it?
There's just a difference. There's a different, maybe one brain cell on one side that just, it makes sense you're a songwriter more than this. And that whole aspect of it then brings you down a different road musically, because like Roy Wood released Boulders in 1973. He played all the instruments. I had that Jason Faulkner album, Author Unknown, his first album. That was all him playing the instruments. And I found an amazing connection between those two when I heard them. One was 30 years later or whatever. But it's amazing because there's a certain element of a guy or a woman playing all the instruments.
Yeah.
And adding this incredible extra layer of melody onto it. It's a weird thing. So Rory Gallagher, he's not so much known as a writer, really.
No, he's not.
A player.
Yeah, like I think of all of those guitar players, the best songwriter, like I'm talking about Clapton and Rory Gallagher and
Jeff
Beck, but the best writer was really, for me, is Jimi Hendrix. Because like all of his gets, like he could do both. He could write those like lovely George, you know, melodic things, but he could solo play the blues. But his lyrics were, he also created this world around, you know, sci-fi, you know.
Yes.
Purple season, different, yeah.
Rainbow Bridge kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But that's why he's special though, Colin.
Yeah, he's very special.
He is a legend. That's why he is revered, because there was nobody like him.
Yeah.
Personally, I think there was nobody like George Harrison, but there was plenty of people similar to him. Yeah. Now, in a way, you know, you look back and there was similar kind of players like Jeff Beck when it comes to Hendrix and stuff like that. Clapton, of course. Hendrix was, but then again, like we always love the people we love for whatever reasons.
Yeah.
There's no explaining it, but Hendrix obviously had people he adored.
Yeah.
You know, Hendrix, he liked the Bee Gees, he liked the Monkees and all. I mean, you know, he was.
Yeah. Well, he just created an amazing repertoire of songs that are to listen to. But yeah, I know what you're saying. There's no hierarchy either. There's different things for different people, and there's no. One thing I wanted to ask you was, when you're writing, do you write in bursts, or like you were talking about not listening to music for 18 months? Do you absorb things that happen and then just have a writing period, or?
This is my biggest horror. I mean, I truly hate it. I mean, see, it is like a drug, because you know the feeling at the end of it. You know there's an incredible release at the end. And you sit there every day and go, oh, yeah. That's a great feeling. But I haven't written anything in 6 months. But you know, so you can fall into the trap of just knowing you can do it, but every time you have to go and do it again, because this is the thing, no one's asking me to make a record, right? Well, fans are, right? That's fair. And that's lovely, and that's why we love them and all. But there's nobody kicking my door down, like, say, you know, the next Tame Impala album or something, you know, to say, we desperately need a record from you. That's a pressure I could work under. I think I have with the second Duckworth Lewis. We did kind of do that record, even though we did it, we loved what we did, and we did it right. You know, we were kind of thinking, well, we should do one now, and, you know, so we have to do it. So I could do it, but when it comes naturally, of course, it's fantastic. But lockdown has definitely impacted my writing. See, people think, oh, lockdown's perfect. You know, like McCartney's new one, done in lockdown. Well, you know, McCartney's, again, he's on a different level anyway, right? That's fine. But he also has the greatest studio in the world in his house. And, you know, he is a multi-talented genius. And that's, it's almost, it's his life because of what he's done. And I mean, it's our lives, but we also have the worry of surviving.
Yeah. That's true.
And this plays a huge part in our writing, because if you've spent weeks just surviving and going through the stress of surviving, I don't think sitting down writing a fucking song is going to help.
Right, yeah, yeah.
But that's me. Now, that's why I differ from other people, because other people will have that release.
Yeah. No, but it's fair to say that there's a certain amount of conditions or contentment that is needed for it to be a priority.
You must have the blues to write the blues. I live by that, because I do agree with it, because for years I had a lot of struggles going on when I was writing my main body of work. And in the end, when I look back, it definitely helped. The older you get, because when you're younger, you can battle through, you can walk through the walls and do all that, you know, especially Steve Wall, he's quite thin. So, you know, but you know, you can... You know, you can go through that and not really think about it. But when you get older and, you know, life is a lot more fragile, the worry of having a litre of milk there to have a cup of tea when you're definitely feeling down takes priority. Yeah. And that's sad, but it's real. And then in the end, when you do have that window of time to write where everything is kind of okay, you can go back on that feeling and put it into the songs. That's the way I do it. There's a lot of stuff being stored. I've written a lot over the last year, but I don't want to get in and hone it yet. I don't want to, because I almost feel, like I always do, that there's going to be 10 days or 2 weeks where I go nuts. Because even my last album as an example, I wrote it in 3 weeks.
Well, is that not your process, that you have this, I've seen you do it a couple of times, where you just allow this build-up of things.
Yeah.
And it's percolating in your head. And you have your eye on all these different things, and you're probably squirreling it away and this, that, and the other. And then it's that intensive period that you actually really just let it all, you know.
Yeah. For me personally, then, it's slightly annoying as well, because you do get a similar level of writing. If you intensely write over 2 or 3 weeks, there's going to be things that sound a little similar. There's going to be lyrical ideas that are a little similar.
Yeah.
If you just say in the old fashioned way, you only want 10 or 11 tracks for an album, you make sure you pick the ones that are diverse enough, lyrically diverse enough, and you get in there and you really work on them. And that's why there's nothing better when you know you've written 20 songs and you have 10. So it's always double for me, pretty much, because the last one, I ended up writing 25 and I only wanted to write 10. I was lucky because there was a good 14 that weren't good enough. But then again, of course, you go back 3 years later and you have a look and you go, that was actually a good song.
Well, that's what, like, you were talking about Macca there doing his album. And, like, I watched a couple of interviews, and it turns out that some of the songs were from, I think, when he was doing something with George Martin.
Oh, yeah, tracks from 1992.
Yeah. So, 1992. Look, at one of the amazing things that, like, when we were about 20, you kind of had an epiphany talking to you one time. You probably don't remember, but we were talking about music. Like, we always have great musical chats, but you were saying to me about, I think you've just come out and said, like, I remember we were quite young at the time. You had just kind of said, oh, yeah, well, like, I'm into, you know, arranging. And I was like, what do you mean? He goes, well, everything. You know, figuring out what the drums does and the bass does. I think you were at the producing someone's EP down in Windmill Lane or something. And you wrote the trumpet part. And
yeah, yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And I was quizzing you about that. I was like, why would you do that? And you were like, well, that's what I'm into. That's what I'm going to be doing. That's what these songs. You had your demos. Nothing was released. It was years before you released that.
92.
So the thing that impressed me was, considering the way you would present yourself on the guitar as saying, well, I'm not really that musical, you were able to hear a lot of the musical parts in your head. And that's what happened with Pugwash as well. And with like other albums, you go in that 3 week period, you say, and you just start, you know, you're working with the musicians.
Yeah.
I suppose you're kind of musically directing, but like, how would you kind of describe that skill? Like how did you get that? Was it from listening to music or like obsessively listening to music? Is that what it was?
Well, that's where, you know, inevitably, that's where Jeff Lynne comes in for me. Because when I started listening to ELO records, I just couldn't get over the amount of levels on the records. They kind of say now is over the top, whatever. And of course, it's not now. They're loved now, you know. They're back to being loved and Hall of Famers and everything. Inspirational and Ed Sheeran and singing with them and Dave Grohl and all these people. But, you know, I was through them dark years where they were hated. They were the anti-punk, you know, for a long time. But then, funny enough, you see a lot of the punk keys is talking about them in later years because, you know, they all secretly liked them. So, but regardless of all that, because it was tough, because you'd say those, you'd say him and they'd all just think of his glasses and his hair. Which they still do, in fairness. He still wears them. Yeah. But when I listened to the records, I couldn't get over. Because, like, you can listen to an ELO album 10 years after buying it or 20 years after listening to it for 20,000 times, you suddenly go, oh, I always thought that was a flu.
Mm.
And you listen again, you go, oh my God, it's a vocal. It's a vocal. Okay. And then you listen and listen, and you go, oh my God, it's totally a vocal. That's the kind of thing that, for me, Jeff Lynne's music still does. I still put on an album and I go, oh my God, that's actually a drum hitting there. I thought that was an X, Y, or Z.
Yeah.
So music that constantly gives like that, and is layered at such a level where they're still finding things decades later. That always blew my mind. And the Beatles, the funny thing is with the Beatles, we all know how sparsely they were recorded. They had on four tracks up till Pepper.
Yeah.
Four tracks up till after Pepper, you know, sitting there with their pencils on their, you know, sitting outside the room and making the tape go, you know, 500 yards long to get loops and all.
Yeah.
I mean, this is primitive stuff. But their music sounded like gold.
Yeah,
but it was primitive. You could actually listen to it and go, "Oh, that's there, that's there. George Martin's doing that there." But then ELO for me took her on to this level where there's like choirs and orchestras and harpsichords and there's guitar parts going there and there's vocals all over the place. So that got me really interested in singing parts because I remember I was very young reading a Bee Gees book. Barry Gibb says, "I don't know how to write music. I never have." So when we met Bill Shepherd, which was their arranger, Barry Gibb would sing his parts to his arranger. I read that as a kid, I thought that's after opening up a whole new world because I was never going to be right.
Yeah.
You know, I got my Tascam 4 track. I recorded wrongly on it for years. And then one day I actually picked up the manual and went, oh, well, you can put those up and it won't bleed into the next track. Oh, God, yeah. Look, it was so simple, but I just had this almost stupid refusal to read manuals and stuff.
Yeah.
So I am that person. But when I found out you could sing your parts and other people would interpret them and then put them down for you, that was great. So I did that with that session. I had this trumpet part. And so, yeah, early, good memory there, Colm.
Yeah. I think probably when you said that to me, it probably passed that idea onto me as well, as that as a songwriter, it's not necessarily just about the chords and the lyrics and a riff. It's also, you can take an interest in what the drums are doing and what the, you know, brass instruments and strings. And knowing that that was something that you had your eye on from the get-go was, you know, because when you learn the guitar, like, that's interesting. And then you write some lyrics and then that's interesting, you sing. But I think as you develop as a songwriter through the years, you're always looking for new things to do and discover.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I kind of built on things, you know, just.
Yeah, well, I don't know what happens with you, but when I start writing, and I specifically say for an album, that's kind of happened, say, and you're writing, and if I get a good song and I've pretty much written it and I sit down to final demo it into my phone, say, when I start playing it, I can hear everything on that track. Just that I could definitely hear that it's going to work.
Yeah.
So once that's in your head that sonically this is going to sound really good, then the little bits, that's when production really rears its wonderful head in the studio.
Yeah.
As you know that it's going to work, so that's fine. But then when you go in, you start hearing it repeatedly when you're recording it and whatever else, you start going, okay, that should go in there. Put that in there. Can we try that? You hear it pretty much 90% finished. That's when you go in the studio and the production head comes into play and you know the little spots where you're going to pop things in. And then, of course, things that happen on the spur of the moment, which are brilliant. And that's when other musicians have their say and have their and shine.
Yeah.
You know, when they do their things. And that's what makes it all very, very beautiful and worthwhile. You remember quotes from when you were a kid and when you were younger. And I remember reading Billy Joel saying that he hates the songwriting process so much because it's so painful for him.
Ooh.
He literally sweats blood.
Yeah.
Finishing a song. And I never went, that's ridiculous. I remember at the time hearing it when I was young, kind of going, well, that kind of makes a bit of sense.
Yeah.
You know, even though I was crap and I wasn't writing it. And I was like, say, first song, I remember it was C to G minor, which was my first, just straight away, it wasn't normal.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It was a
blast.
Don't let, I don't remember the lyrics. I remember the first couple of lines, but then it goes a bit weird. Don't let that grass grow under your feet. It's the hardest thing to do. Something like that, right?
Sounds great.
It's not. But, you know, it was the fact that G minor sounded very exciting.
Yeah.
And then years later, when you listen to Tom Petty being interviewed, and he's talking about meeting Jeff Lynne, because Tom Petty's career was obviously very big, but it had gone a bit weird until he met Jeff Lynne. And then they started hanging out and having fun.
Yeah.
But he was like, he said, I have this song, Jeff, and it was like, well, I walk back down, right? So I walk back down. And Jeff went, well, what about not playing C and playing E minor? So it was like, well, I walk back down, so I walk. And instantly Tom Petty said, it gave something that he never would have thought.
Yeah.
The minors, he says, Jeff Lynne was just all about minors.
Yeah.
And so when I was thinking my first song, it was like, da, 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 you know, straight into the minors.
It's such a Lennon thing as well, though, isn't it? Like the,
well, it is.
Across the Universe and If I Fell, just those lovely chromatic minors going up and down.
Yeah. Well, the intro to If I Fell is just, you know, so ridiculous. I don't... If I fell in love with you, would you promise to be true and help me? That intro to If I Fell is a great example.
He is a board.
And yeah. Also, Not a Second Time from With the Beatles, which is the... you know you made me cry. I see the reason to dance by my cry. Oh, you. It's just sevenths and minors. It's just like 1963.
Yeah,
it's really was.
I'd imagine Roy Orbison was a big influence there as well, you know.
Well, it's amazing because Roy Orbison goes into the category of the Beatles, but not someone that I was obsessed with at all.
Yeah.
But somebody that you knew all their songs because you didn't know why you knew all their songs.
Yeah, because that's how good they were.
That's how good they were. So always played, people obsessed with them.
Yeah.
You know, Irish people, working class Irish people, it would be Roy Orbison, the Beatles, it would be Perry Como, it would be, you know, Frank Sinatra, it would be all those. And then when they had to give in the early 60s to pop, you know, there was only certain ones that accept. So my dad was a bit iffy with the Beatles, but my man liked them.
Yeah.
You know, he'd like some Roy Orbison songs, but he'd be going, he's now Frank.
Okay. You know? Yeah.
All that stuff.
Everybody was measured against Frank.
Oh, you can't meet anybody who was born in the 30s in the world who doesn't have Frank Sinatra as the...
Well, come here, you said something interesting there about, you were talking about Billy Joel, and it's something I wanted to touch on. Like, obviously, like we talked about music, and that's a big part of it. I think what Billy was probably talking about, because again, I think songwriters and musicians love to play music, but I think the more difficult part can be the lyrics and I think that's the excruciating part. Not only the lyrics, but trying to attach those lyrics to melodies. you're very melodic and you like coming up with melodies, but sometimes getting a topic but then getting them to fit. Do you want to talk about lyrics a bit? Like, what's your, you definitely have a very specific way in writing. I won't say anything about it as of yet, but I'd just like to know where you're coming from when you're sitting down to write.
The barrier at the moment to not finishing a record at the moment would be the lyrics. Only the last few nights, I wrote a couple of things to a friend of mine whose mother passed. The lyrics are there because I am comfortable with how to express kind of feelings in lyrical form or writing to people. I have no problem with that. I think there's actually, it's amazing how much, and I don't respect this enough, but you can talk to people about bereavement or about life and it can be fine, but it's amazing how different you can put it in writing. I suppose it's the fact that this is why writing should never be lost. You know the way people are saying it's less and less now?
Underestimated or, yeah.
Yeah, it's, you know, because people obviously just on computers all day and the fact of writing something. But, you know, I like the fact that you still write on a computer. You still write to somebody. I don't go down the road of the small text, you know, the LOL text and stuff like that. I don't do that so much. Mm. I like doing it when I have to do it. But if it's a personal thing or something a bit more emotionally charged, you know, I can write still because I am 51. And I remember writing to pen pals, and I remember writing letters to people I was buying records of. Can I please put in a bid for your record of £2, please?
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
Yeah. In writing.
Because you have to send it in writing. Yeah. Can you imagine that? You know, seeing a record for sale, and it was saying bids start at £3 or something.
Yeah.
And you go, I'd like to offer £4, please, in a letter.
Yeah.
Again, another person who's influenced me a lot is Michael Penn, because I thought his lyrics were out of this world. Every song, you go somewhere with it. John Lennon's lyrics would be incredibly simple. But he was always annoyed about his lyrics, Lennon, because he thought they were just too moany and too whiny. So, you know, he'd write a song like Sweet Board of Paradox on Walls and Bridges, which is about May Pang, the girl he was having the affair with. Yeah, he likes that. You know, it's a great song, but it's a real silly song with silly lyrics. But the rest of the, you can just know he forced that out of himself, because the rest of the album is just about him questioning his life and everything.
Yeah.
But that's what he did best, you know, and that's why I tend to be the same in that respect. I mean, I know your songs for years. I always think there's a far more positive view of your writing, you know, lyrically and stuff, than mine. That's just what I notice.
Yeah.
But there is an element, there is a side to your writing, of course, as well, which can get obviously quite personal, obviously.
Yeah.
But I tend to, the older I get, I don't know about yourself, but tends to remain about the frailties of our existence, really.
It's funny you say, like, the Lennon thing, because it just really became apparent to me when I just watched that Lennon movie again, Above Us Only Sky.
Yeah, it's brilliant, dude.
And when I was just thinking about your lyric writing approach, I kind of realized, like, going back to Almond Tea, all of the albums, like particularly your first one, you had that Lennon thing from the get-go in that classic thing they say, write about what you know about. And you were writing about things that were happening to you in your life that you knew about. You could say that that's simplistic, but I think the other word that you used earlier was the connection, is that it actually has, it's genuine. Actually, I think that's why people really felt it, because you were singing about things that weren't just words put down the page because you had to do it. You were like, well, this is actually something that happened in my life. And it was expressed. And I think when it hits the melody, then when the words and the melody come together, there's that extra, honesty or something, or connection. And
well, I mean, my first single, right, was, you know, it was, as you know well, it's If I Fail, If I Fail is the first shouting lyric.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Yeah. And not only is that just a direct and utter reference to Lennon, I decided to go, If I Fail,
yeah.
You know, which is his chord.
Yeah.
It's John Lennon's chord.
Yeah.
You know, would you stop to pick me up? If I cry, would you wipe away the tears? You know, it's cool when you get into that scenario, you know yourself, where, okay, yeah, if I cry, would you do that? If I did that, would you do that? And you can want, but like, you can write 12 of them.
Yeah.
If I, whatever, right. If I run, would I sweat a lot? You know, you do anything.
Yeah, yeah.
If I scream, would I scream as loud as you? You know, you could just, of course, they're crap. But then you get the good ones.
But that's a real Lennon thing as
well. I think similes? No?
No, I'm not sure, actually. I don't think
I haven't got a clue, but there's something. They use them a lot.
They're definitely little John Lennonisms, because he used to do that with his lyrics so much. Like, he'd come up with a little thing where he'd go, there's nowhere you should be where you're not supposed to be. There's nowhere you should be. You know, and he'd done that with so...
Same example of it.
It was like, as soon as he got that little trick in his head, he was able to go, yes. That's the song written. I just need to go, you know, if you run, if you hide, if you... Yeah.
Well, you're giving me goosebumps there, because that's it in a nutshell. You know, because All You Need Is Love is... My favourites is... Is that thing you can know that isn't known?
Yeah.
No way you can see that isn't shown, you know.
Yeah.
So good that.
Yeah. And then
don't be done that before him.
And then another one is Love Is Real, Real Is Love. Love yes. Is This. You know, it was like a kind of, it was like a mirror effect. You know, it's very artistic and very visual, like the way he kind of puts lyrics.
It's him, isn't it? Strictly him.
Yeah, it's very unique.
But it's a great point. I want to just go back to it, because you definitely nailed something. Which is really cool. In that, an Almond Tea, my first album, talk about the Lennon thing. Well, it's simply because on your first album, especially for me, I hadn't lived my life at all.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're only starting, you're only beginning to experience life at 20 years of age or whatever.
Yeah.
Now, I didn't release it until I was 29, but all the songs were written around 20, 21, that kind of time. You're totally going to reflect what's most influencing you, and it was John Lennon.
Yeah.
You know, as much as I idolized Jeff Lynne, he wasn't somebody I wanted to try and write like.
Yeah.
It was John Lennon I wanted to write like.
Yeah.
Because there was an immediacy to his stuff. It was just like, how can he make Klaus Voormann, Ringo, and him sound so awesome on Isolation?
Yeah.
And of course, Isolation is... You know what I mean? And it's like, you know, it might as well be for anything in life. But yeah. Honestly, I never thought it was. Yeah. I never subconsciously went, oh, yeah, I can put that now into A. Never did.
Yeah.
That's why I always feel comfortable in my writing, because I've never, ever, ever, ever done that.
Yeah. It's that osmosis thing. Going back to, like, that you were listening to so much music all the time that it was going to come out and come through in some sort of way.
It's funny, because if you fast forward to Jollity, which I've just reissued.
Yes, exactly.
You have things like This Could Be Good. Fran King told me, he said, you know that it's All My Loving, that sort of it. I swear to God.
Go for it, shows it.
Of course, it's The Kids Are All Right as well, but I really, really didn't cop either of those. Because I've said this before, I think I spoke about this to Duke Special recently, in that... If you know, if you instantly cop on that there's something similar in what you've written to something famous in a way, if you really like what you've written, because 99% of it is yours, obviously, and then there's that little element that's probably somebody else's that you've just popped in, you'll do your best to change it, because it's too much to lose for so little. It's like the George Harrison thing as well with My Sweet Lord. You know, there was so much other stuff going on. So I won't replicate those mistakes that were made. Right now, The Kids Are All Right is right, so it's that.
Yeah.
But I went, oh my loving, what's he talking about? And then you think, oh, you're I was like, what the heck off.
Yeah, well, it's just that the melody is so different that it, you know, it makes it.
But I really, if I'd have noticed that song would never, probably, not that it would never have happened, but it wouldn't have been the way it is. But to be honest with you, of course, you listen to it and it's nothing like either of the songs.
Yeah.
Because it's not. But there's that element of it. And I love the fact that, because let's face it, we're not robots.
No.
How can you not stick a little bit of Bob Dylan in subconsciously in a song if you're writing a particular type of song? Like, I was trying to write a real pop single there.
Yeah.
So, of course, The Who and The Beatles are going to be in there somewhere.
Yeah, it's going to show up.
Yeah.
And look, that's what they were doing as well. They were just regurgitating their, you know, people that they loved. And I suppose that's what folk music is. It's just reinventing something and repurposing it, making it sound new and fresh.
Yeah, and they took it to a, just a quick aside, they took it to a different level, because John Lennon, because he knew who he was, and not in a bad way, because he was never like that, but he knew how big the Beatles were, and they were pretty untouchable, of course. So when he wrote Come Together, you know, every one of the Beatles said, look, this is, you know, this is Chuck Berry. Yeah, come on, flat top, right? It's directly taken.
Yeah, lyrically.
Yeah, yeah, I know. He says, well, you know, we're the Beatles. There's that, there's a little element of that, because, of course, the song means so much more now.
Yeah, yeah.
Not that you don't know the Chuck Berry, a lot of people don't know the Chuck Berry song, but either way, it doesn't make any difference. It's a completely separate entity.
Yeah.
But it's hugely influenced. But the thing is, Chuck Berry made millions out of his association with the Beatles, and he loved it, and he played on it.
Yeah.
So great, more power to him, because he deserved it, because he's a legend.
Yeah. Yeah, like, there's a difference between ripping someone off and giving a nod to some...
You know, homage.
Homage, yeah.
That's the defense in the courtroom.
It's a homage, yeah. I was paying...
I was paying my respects,
Your Honor.
Yeah. You couldn't convince that judge, though, my sweet lord.
So, come here, I want to finish up with this, because we're coming up on the hour. Or I just want to mention, because we're going to be putting this out on the on Instagram and Facebook. Jollity is just being put out on vinyl. Play us out with Nice to Be Nice.
A little bit of Nice to Be Nice?
A little bit, yeah.
I've no problem with that at all. For you, anything.
Thanks a million for having us.
Nice to be nice, as my mama once said. It's good to be good, and it's fun to be fun. It's nice to be nice, as no one would say. It's good to be good.
That was lovely. Thanks a million. And thanks for being the first guest on Songwriters Powwow.
Well, you're a legend, and thank you for thinking of me.
All right.
I hope somebody has learned something. But if you didn't, don't worry about it, because we all follow our own pathway.
Brilliant. Well said.